Hey everyone, I'm Kaitlyn Barnard.
And I'm Viktor Gamov.
In this series, we chat with software developers and technology leaders to tackle your biggest API connectivity challenges.
Stay tuned to this episode for tools, tactics, strategies that will help you to take your distributed architectures to the next level. Let's begin.
So today, I'm joined by Viktor Farcic, developer advocate at Upbound. Viktor is going to talk to us today about the importance of enabling developers to manage infrastructure.
Or I would correct myself saying enable developers to manage everything, infrastructure, applications, everything.
So I guess, can we dive right in? Can you give us a rundown of the importance of that? You know, why are we talking about enabling developers to really manage all aspects of what they're doing?
I believe that we need to break the vicious cycle of me asking you to do something and then that something goes in a queue when you're available to do that something and so on and so forth. There is actually data to back it up that self-sufficient teams are always more efficient than teams that depend on each other. And to be self-sufficient means that, hey, you need to write code of your application, you need to test your application, you need to create the infrastructure you need to deploy your applications and so on and so forth, right? So we are talking about teams taking control of a full life cycle of their applications from having an idea, hey, my application should do this, until that application is up and running in production successfully.
In this series, we're talking all about how the different problems and topics that we're chatting about relate back to connectivity and common connectivity challenges that teams are facing. Can you give us a little overview of how that relates to really what you're doing with extending the Kubernetes API?
Actually, a combination of Kubernetes API and scheduler, or to be more precise, it's the whole idea that when we want to do something, we should propagate information about what we want to do to some API and let the scheduler manage or figure out what needs to be done, right? So it's very similar to the operator model that we have in Kubernetes. We do not necessarily say, hey, run this application for me. Instead, we say, when we communicate with Kubernetes, we say, hey, I have this application and I would like it to run successfully inside of a cluster. Whether that means that you should scale up or scale down, whether you should run it on this node or that node is not anymore our job. We are not imperative in that sense anymore. We are more defining the desired state. And when we translate that to infrastructure, we get something similar, right? We are defining the state of what we want to do instead of executing commands that will create something or destroy something or scale something and so on and so forth. So it's a conceptually very different approach between being imperative and being declarative, and more importantly than that, letting some other process somewhere, in this case scheduler, make sure that those desires or desired states are fulfilled and continue to be fulfilled.
And I'm going to, you know, I'm going to use Kubernetes as an example here, but Kubernetes itself can be really complex. And not everyone at a company is going to be a Kubernetes expert. Can you talk a little bit about how the people at the company who are the Kubernetes experts can enable those developers or folks who maybe aren't to manage that without having to submit a ticket for every request?
Yes. So it's all about really creating services that others can consume instead of fulfilling requests from others. If you take, let's say, AWS or Google Cloud or Azure as example, they're doing precisely that. They're considered almost like a team that provides services to people in a company, right? And they do not provide those services by you saying, hey, dear AWS, can you create a node, a server for me? No, they create a service that we can consume, right? And those services are much easier than if you would try to figure out all that by ourselves. Even infrastructure people who are deep into infrastructure, very often do not understand how hypervisors work because that is simplified for them, right? Now, if we move towards developers, the job of experts, let's say, and those experts can be security experts, networking experts, infrastructure experts, and so on and so forth. The job of those experts is not to do stuff for others, but to create a service that is consumable by other teams with just enough details to cover the needs of those teams. Like if you say, hey, I will allow the developer to create a cluster, let's say a Kubernetes cluster. That developer doesn't care about subnets, doesn't probably even know what subnets or VPCs are. That developer cares, hey, I need a big cluster or a small cluster. I need it to run in the US or in Europe, right? Some relatively basic questions, which are actually not necessarily basic for that developer, but basic from the perspective of a person who spends all his life, every single day, dealing with infrastructure, right? So we want to enable developers by giving them services with just the right level of abstraction that those developers have freedom to do what they want without going completely crazy, right? Without having to spend a year trying to figure out how that something works, because we don't have that amount of time.
And one of the things we've been talking a lot about at Kong recently is it's really not a great experience for a development team or an ops team to kind of, you know, someone makes a technology decision and then that's thrown at them without having any say over it and they have to manage it or use it, something like that. I'm really curious, how does this influence now how developers and ops teams can pick technology?
It's a bit complicated, right? Because you want developers to pick the technology because you want them to be self-sufficient. And you cannot be self-sufficient. You cannot take control of your life, of your situation, of your project without making those decisions. But on the other hand, you're not equipped to make those decisions very often. Like if you ask developer, hey, should you run it in zone A or zone B? He doesn't know that. He cannot make those decisions, but he should still have the right to do those decisions, right? We should have different levels of abstraction, and then I, as a person, can choose which layer of or level of abstraction suits me, right? I want it to be just dummy. I want a cluster. I don't care where it runs, how big it is, and so on and so forth. I can do that. You want to go deeper? Excellent. You want to go even deeper? Excellent. And ultimately, there always needs to be a choice, pro-choice person, in terms that, hey, if you want to create a cluster from scratch by yourself, great, do it, because it's your application, you're responsible for it, you will suffer the consequences or reap the benefits. If you want to use the service that I prepared for you that will simplify that for you, even better, right? Because then my work, you're benefiting from my work. As long as it is clear that I'm not responsible for your decisions, right? Using my service or creating from scratch or anything between does not remove responsibility from the team that is consuming that something.
You know, diving a little bit into that, when you're creating these services or defining these opinions, how do you enforce them? You know, how do you make sure that you're putting all this power in the hands of other teams? How do you make sure that nothing goes awry and we're not at the end of the day creating more work, you know, for the team providing those services?
It's complicated, right? You employ a bunch of policies and say you can do this, you cannot do that. And you combine those policies with some kind of abstractions, right? So like what I mentioned before, and in our case, we call it composites, that, hey, I'm going to combine those 57 different types of resources into something very simple for you to consume. And I'm going to create policies in parallel with that that will prevent you from going crazy. So let's say if I have an abstraction or composite that says, hey, pick how many nodes you want in your cluster, I would have a policy that says it cannot go above 6. If you create it and it goes above 6, then you will get a warning that, hey, that's... So I see it almost like I have a daughter, a small one, and sometimes we go bowling and then I do not throw the ball for her, right? That completely ruins the fun element. But I do lift the rails so she cannot go outside of the lane. So it's completely okay. She can do anything she wants with the ball. She can miss all the pins or she can have a strike, but she cannot go outside of the lane because I lifted the rails for her, right? So it's a choice with guardrails in a way.
Yeah, I love that analogy. Awesome. Well, you know, we're kind of talking about simplifying this and how we can make that possible. So maybe why don't we dive in? Why don't you show us?
So here I have a terminal, which I split into two screens because I want to show how it looks from developer perspective, which would be this screen just a second, which would be this screen over here. And the screen on my right would be what operators see, people, you know, who create those layers of abstraction. Now, from developer perspective, I can have something like this. So let's say that I, as a developer, I defined that I want to have a cluster, and I defined it like this. There is no mention of Kubernetes. There is no mention of anything that I theoretically, depending on my level of understanding or expertise, can handle. So I'm saying, hey, I want to create something called composite cluster. Composite cluster was defined by the other me, by operator, right? It's a completely custom defined definition of something, right? Not defined by any product in advance. And I'm saying, hey, I am called Team A, and I will create a cluster in AWS. I could have done exactly the same in Google Cloud or in Azure, assuming that the other me, the operator, defined those things. So it really depends on the boundaries that somebody else established, or and also about the possibilities that somebody created for me. But in this case, I made the choice as a developer. I'm going to have a cluster in AWS, and I specify that I want to have small nodes. And you can see by the comments that somebody prepared for me, it can be small, medium, and large. And what that really means is that I do not know whether I want T2, medium, or T3, X, large, or whatever are the AWS specific sizes. I have a simple way to say, hey, it's small, medium, or large. And it's somebody else's job to figure out how to translate that into something that AWS understands. So I specified small, and I kept the version of the Kubernetes cluster and the minimum number of nodes commented, right? Mostly for you to see here. But essentially, if I would remove those comments, I could get away by just saying I want small cluster with small nodes. Now, from operator's perspective, what we actually really got, and I already actually, let me backtrack a second. Since it takes like 15 to 20 minutes to create everything in AWS, I already created that in advance. And the way how I did it is actually that I pushed this file to this directory, which is in a Git repository, and it is being managed by Argo CD. So I, as a developer, I create some YAML definitions, I push them to Git, and then Argo CD creates whatever needs to be created inside my Kubernetes cluster. And from there on, Crossplane, when it notices that there are some definitions that it should work with, does the rest of the job. And in this case, the rest of the job, I will show you here. Actually, let me copy the command because it's a pretty big one. What happened in the background when developer defined this, pushed to Git, and Argo CD did this job was that those things were created. I'm sorry for the resolution here. I'm trying to keep it large so that you can see it. But anyways, behind this simple definition, we got an EKS cluster, we got a node group, we got two IAM roles and some policy attachments, 4 or 5. We got VPC, we got security groups, 3 subnets, internet gateway, routes table, and we got Helm configurations so that inside of that cluster, so that not only that cluster was created in AWS, but inside of that cluster, there are some components running or some components were applied. And in this case, that's KubeVela. So all those things are absolutely, except maybe KubeVela, all those things are absolutely necessary. And somebody needs to figure out what those things are and how to combine them and all those things. But from developer perspective, I said, I want a cluster. I have a service. I can consume it. I can have control over that service, but within those guardrails that I mentioned before, within the boundaries that somebody else defined. And those boundaries are usually based on the potential experience that I have as a developer. If I knew more about AWS, then maybe I would get more control. If I knew less, maybe I would get less control. It really depends on establishing the balance between developers or people on the left. It's actually strange to say developers because everybody's developing these days. Everybody's writing some code. But people on the left, people in charge of applications. Let me find an example how that looks from operator perspective. And that would be Crossplane. Let me find it. Compositions. Yes. Now, that operator did was define this. And this is all the madness that you need to work on when working with AWS, right? All the things that we saw as the resources being created are defined here in YAML and hidden basically from end users, or in this case from developers. What developers actually saw was this definition that says, hey, implementation is somewhere else. What matters is that I'm going to expose to developers version and node size and mid node count. So this is a type of contract that is established between consumers of this composite. And on the other hand, is also a contract that implementations of that composite need to take into account and then build all those dozens of resources that I showed before. And my cluster is up and running, and I can demonstrate that if I find the command, which is export kubeconfig equals that. Here we are, kubeconfig kubectl get nodes. This is still me as an operator. You can see that here is my cluster with a single node because I was too cheap. I didn't want to spend too much money on you guys. But anyways, my cluster is up and running with all the resources required, with all security hardening that I could imagine, with all the applications applied and up and running in that cluster. And all that I had to do as a developer was just define this and push to Git. I did not even execute kubectl. And I could go even further. I could say, hey, let me combine this with applications. And in this case, I will be using kubevela. Everything you saw so far was Crossplane. And I could do something like this. I could say, hey, I can do something similar for your applications. And instead of you defining a bunch of Kubernetes resources like ingress, service deployment, stateful set, Istio, this and that, I can say, hey, all that out, I defined also application model for you. You can have different type of components. And in this example, I'm using one component called backend, the other one called frontend. What they do is really, or how they do stuff is not necessarily my concern. What is my concern is that I'm saying here, but for the frontend, I'm going to use this image. I'm going to add autoscaler with the minimum number of nodes being 3. Now, what is that autoscaler? How it works? The details of it, again, are hidden from me, and I will use ingress. And all I have to do is push that to the specific directory as a developer. Actually copy it to the specific directory of a Git repository, push it to Git. And now within 3 minutes, it will be up and running. And the reason why it will be up and running, because there is Argo CD in the background communicating with Kubernetes API, creating those resources or applying those resources, and then Crossplane taking over and making sure that those resources are applied within the infrastructure and within the boundaries that somebody defined. And now I think that I'm not sure whether we want to wait up to 3 minutes, but within a few minutes, my application will be up and running in the cluster.
Awesome. Thank you so much for that quick demo, Viktor. That was a perfect way, I think, to see everything that we were talking about. And I'm not sure we mentioned it at the beginning, but Crossplane is completely open source and a sandbox project of CNCF, correct?
Correct. It's sandbox right now. I think we are moving to the next level in probably before this gets aired, it will not be sandboxed anymore.
All right.
At least that's the plan.
Any other final comments before, you know, we close this out for the viewers?
I don't know. Like, try it out and ping me if you need any help.
Cool. Yeah, that's the spiel I'm going to give. That, you know, be sure to check out the links in the description of this video. There'll be links out to Crossplane, to Viktor to get more information, and, you know, all the resources that we have to really enable your teams to shift left and empower developers to manage their own infrastructure and everything, as we talked about. Thanks to everyone out there for watching. I hope you enjoyed today's episode as much as we enjoyed recording it. Make sure to hit that like button now.
And be sure to subscribe so you don't miss a new episode.
Don't forget to drop us a comment if you have any questions for today's guest or if there's a topic you'd like to see us cover in the future.
And we will see you on the next episode of Kongcast.